This film was produced by the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences and was made possible by support from the Pulitzer Center. The world, it seems, is in a battle for truth. Social media have become an accelerant for the spread of both misinformation and disinformation about everything from climate change to public health to politics. And the rise of generative AI will only make the problem more intractable. Left unchecked, misinformation will do real damage to people and institutions. But now, at multiple forums around the world, interdisciplinary researchers are coming together to pinpoint the nature of this infodemic and discuss solutions.
I'm Sander van der Linden. I'm a professor of psychology at the University of Cambridge, and I study how people are influenced by misinformation and how we can counter it.
I think misinformation really impacts us in two different ways. It could be direct, in terms of threatening our own health, but it could also be more indirect, in terms of eroding trust in democracy and the electoral process.
So what exactly is misinformation? It's defined as any sort of false or misleading information, whether on social media or even in a journal paper. Disinformation, on the other hand, is false information spread with nefarious intent. Whatever the classification, deceptive news has an impact. The extent of the impact and the spread has as much to do with human psychology as it does with the rancor of the message itself.
Social media platforms are designed for engagement, right? I mean, they want more people to be on the platform and they want these people to engage with one another. When they see that there is some engagement going on a post, then they spread this post even further so that, you know, they will maximize the engagement.
Jaylon set up an experiment. She rewarded one group of people for sharing accurate information online. She rewarded another group for sharing misinformation.
But when we took the rewards away, we looked at their behavior. When we rewarded them for accurate information, they continued sharing accurate information even when the rewards went away. But what is even more interesting is that when asked, everybody was super motivated to share accurate information, even when they didn't do it. This is telling us that it's not our motivation that's driving our behavior on these platforms. It's the habits that we are building on these platforms that drive the ultimate behavior.
The research underscores the notion that at least some of the onus is on these platforms. And they do, in fact, have teams in place to mitigate misinformation.
Content moderation is, at the end of the day, is always going to be about trade-offs and trying to figure out balancing that trade-off. I think it's really important for us to have policies in place and be transparent about the policies. Also, make sure that we are getting the balance between free expression and safety, right?
Facebook spends lots of time and money on moderation. But are they doing enough? For one former employee, the answer is an emphatic no.
Facebook does not allocate spending based on absolute need. They do it based on fear of consequences. I don't think Facebook ever set out to intentionally promote divisive, extreme, polarizing content. I do think, though, that they are aware of the side effects of the choices they have made around amplification. And they know that algorithmic-based ranking, so engagement-based ranking, keeps you on their sites longer. You have longer sessions, you show up more often, and that makes them more money. Amplification algorithms, things like engagement-based ranking on Instagram, can lead children from very innocuous topics like healthy recipes to anorexia-promoting content over a very short period of time.
In October 2023, more than 40 states sued Meta and its platforms, claiming they're detrimental to children's mental health. In January, Meta announced controls that they say will hide harmful Facebook and Instagram content from kids' feeds. Oftentimes, It's not enough to tell people the truth. After all, one person's truth can be another person's conspiracy theory. So how do you convince people they've been misled without you yourself becoming an arbiter of truth? One approach, reveal the strategies of those attempting to deceive.
My colleague Carl Bergstrom and I, many years ago, started gathering lots and lots of examples of things that we were seeing in our personal world and our professional world when it comes to misinformation. So we wanted to teach students and the public more broadly how to call BS.
So here's an example from a scientific paper. And what this paper purports to do is to show a relationship between the prevalence of autism and the level of coverage in a population by the measles, mumps, rubella vaccine, the MMR vaccine. And at first glance, like just looking at that looks kind of bad. Until you notice that these axes are completely different. This one goes from 0 to 0.6%. This one starts at 86% and goes up to 95%. Here's a more reasonable graph, again with two different axes. Fine, the numbers are in different scales. But in this case, you know, we're including zero on both sides. And what we see is that there are very small fluctuations in MMR coverage and many-fold changes in autism prevalence. If anything, indicating that these are unlikely to be causally connected.
The course really arose because of our concern in seeing misinformation traveling in what appeared to be science and what appeared to be sort of data-driven and, you know, evidence-driven kinds of arguments.
The course has proliferated online and at other universities, but it can reach only so many people, and typically a particular demographic, college students. Are there other ways to quickly and simply teach people to detect deception? Could offering the right sort of insights actually protect people from being susceptible to misinformation? Could it inoculate them in a sense?
So the process of psychological inoculation follows the medical analogy almost exactly. Just as you expose someone to a weakened or inactivated strain of a virus to try to trigger the production of antibodies to help confer resistance against future infection. Through research, we found that you can actually do the same with the brain by exposing people to weakened, severely weakened doses of misinformation or the techniques used to produce misinformation.
But how to administer this vaccine? It started with a game.
So we decided to gamify the approach. So we created a game. The initial game was called Bad News, and it was one of the first fake news games, a social media simulation that actually allows people to step into the shoes of an online manipulator and experiment with weakened doses of the more general tactics that are used to deceive people online. The issue is that people often don't have the right mental defenses in place when they're confronted in the moment with manipulation. And so that was really what the game aims to do.
The game works by encouraging players to find unscrupulous ways to garner as many new followers as possible. The game went viral, and Van der Linden saw encouraging results. People even seemed to have some immunity to new variants of misinformation tactics they hadn't seen before. But a realization set in. Not everyone wants to play a game. So the researchers devised animations that humorously illustrated common tactics.
An example would be a false dilemma. So you present two options and pretend there's only two, while in fact there's many more. Politicians love to use that technique, but so do disinformation producers. And you cut out all of the nuance.
Either you stop watching the lamestream media, or you want all puppies to die. Make sense, right? No? Good, because it shouldn't. It's a common manipulation technique called a false dichotomy, or a false dilemma. It's designed to make you think you only got two choices to choose from, when in reality, there are more. As with our little dilemma at the beginning, there's no reason why you can't watch mainstream media and want all puppies to live. The two don't rule each other out. And by presenting you with an option that is clearly undesirable, and the option the manipulator wants you to pick, your choices are narrowed down for you.
Sometimes they use sensationalism, sometimes they appeal to people's emotions, and that can lead people to calibrate their judgments and say, well, I don't find this headline as reliable now that I know that they're trying to use my emotions to influence me. But according to our definition, that's okay, right? We want people to be aware of manipulation regardless of where it's coming from.
Van der Linden refined the videos before inserting them into time slots normally used for ads on YouTube. The campaign reached millions. Those exposed they found were 5 to 10% better than controls at recognizing the manipulation technique in a test headline. It's not a big effect, but it's a potentially important start, especially given what's at stake. If social media has become an accelerant for misinformation, emerging AI tools promise to spread the deception even further and with alarming precision, allowing bad actors to perfectly tailor their morsel of misinformation for maximum impact.
When we get into the world of generative AI, you can now generate 10,000 different lies and figure out what goes viral.
Do you want to talk about abortion, LGBT plus, gun control? You can have an AI generate misleading arguments on those issues really fast, and then you can actually use that to tailor it to different audiences. And in fact, you can even link some of the output to bot accounts and automate the whole process.
The Syrian regime has like whole rooms full of people who report journalist content. To try and alter our information space, say on Facebook or on Twitter. Now, instead of having to hire people, you have generative AI systems that can affect this space. This is a massive risk, and it's absolutely one that we need to be concerned about. And it is novel, both in its amplification, its scale, its cheapness.
Regulations, technical controls, educating about AI capabilities. All of these approaches are in play. Some are interested in embedding a type of watermark in AI-created content to make it easier to identify. Ironclad solutions, however, remain elusive.
How do you design social networks to be safe by design? Like, how do we study how information flows? How do we put in moments of intentionality and friction? You know, how do we make these systems be ones that we don't need to censor because they're not amplifying the most extreme stuff?
To some extent, the way to tackle AI-fueled misinformation involves AI itself.
AI has been instrumental for content moderation and continues to be instrumental for content moderation. Without AI, a tech platform like Meta or some other tech companies would not be able to do content moderation at scale and in a timely fashion.
Unfortunately, moderation, AI-aided or not, may not be enough. Researchers are testing various ways to incentivize the sharing of accurate information.
How are we going to bring this rewarding for accuracy to life? We are now testing different reward structures. What happens if I add a trust button and if a sharer also sees how many trust votes he got or she got, you know, based on the old posts he shared, and what happens to the future posting behavior?
By combining these different interventions at smaller, more reasonable amounts, we saw the most drastic drop in the spread of misinformation.
West looked at interventions that remove posts related to a deceptive one, at ways to automatically shut off sharing if a post spikes in popularity, and at nudges that slow down readers by asking them to consider a claim's accuracy. Each had limitations, but taken together, West found significant knock-on effects. In March, West and colleagues expanded their approach to high school students, emphasizing media literacy via games, lectures, and interactive programs. Van der Linden is working on better inoculation delivery. He hopes trusted messengers, whether influencers, role models, or community leaders, can help maximize uptake. And he started collaborating with educational psychologists, exploring the use of inoculation to make young kids more immune to manipulation before they spend lots of time online. This past spring, Google embarked on an initiative prior to the EU elections to help pre-bunk commonly used manipulation tactics, using, for example, ads that served as informative animations.
We're all at risk of manipulation online right now. One tactic used to manipulate opinion is decontextualization. Can you spot the signs? Generative AI now means that anyone can create video, audio, and images that seem real but are not. But there are a few signs to watch out for. Surprising, shocking, or out of the ordinary content, a source that doesn't look reliable, video, audio, or images that have been edited or repurposed.
The company says its media literacy resources and educational animations reached millions of potential voters in several countries. Google researchers are still working to determine the extent of the project's reach and efficacy. Given the considerable challenges, can we really make significant inroads in the fight to stem the spread of misinformation? Can policymakers and platforms orchestrate that balancing act between free expression and safety?
The technology for spreading misinformation is getting better. It's getting harder and harder to respond to just the scaling aspects of this problem.
In the end, a public health approach might be the best we can do. Inoculate as much as possible, monitor for outbreaks, quash them before they spread. Encourage platforms to improve moderation approaches to meet changing demands. These are the best weapons in the fight to stem misinformation. The stakes are clear. Nothing less than a shared sense of truth.